Have you ever watched cropland or clear-cut woodland grow wild? Bare dirt becomes covered by weeds, then by grasses and annual forbs, and after a few years, you'll see woody and shrubby vegetation emerge, followed by saplings and vines. With time, the saplings eventually become mature trees. This process of change and growth from bare ground to a climax community is known as succession. Succession is a continuous process and is most visible in a natural community that was recently disturbed. In this video segment, we discuss natural and man-made disturbance and how they affect habitat, and how we can use conservation practices to mimic natural disturbance and restore wildlife habitat. Not all disturbance is bad for natural communities. In fact, natural disturbance is vital to providing quality wildlife habitat.
The easiest natural disturbance to use as an example to me is fire. Lightning strikes and natural disturbance from fires were a huge part of the historical management of land, as it could be, for the history of our country. Another great example of a disturbance in the southeast would be a major tropical storm, with the landscape being altered by excessive winds. And it's those events that really do a lot to provide quality wildlife habitat.
Man-made disturbances often have much more permanent effects on the landscape. Here are a few examples.
The obvious man-made disturbances might be wholesale clear-cutting of forested tracts of land, urban development and paving of land, and altering the way water leaves the land into river systems and streams.
You can also think of invasive species as a man-made disturbance. Many agencies believe that invasive species are the biggest threat to wildlife habitat in this country. Here's why.
Typically, invasive species have some pretty common characteristics that they display in their life history. They tend to have really aggressive growth characteristics. They tend to reproduce in large numbers. With these aggressive characteristics that they display in their reproduction and their growth, and all of a sudden you find yourself with a loss of one of the important habitat strata that wildlife would depend on. Typically, that's the herbaceous strata, the short ground-growing plants are the things that you typically see go first in the southeast with some of these highly invasive species that we have.
So how does disturbance fit into the picture for you? As a landowner, you have a toolbox of basic practices that you can use to rid your land of undesirable plant species and to encourage the growth of native plants. In essence, you're trying to mimic natural disturbance and processes to provide the type of habitat you're looking for. Let's take a look at six of these practices. In the southeast, prescribed fire is your practice of choice because it kills off undesirable plants while simultaneously releasing native plant seeds to germinate from the seed bank. We discuss some of the precautions you'll need to take in the supplemental video segment at the end of the series. In forest land, especially in piney woods, consider tree thinning to allow sunlight to penetrate to the forest floor to stimulate the growth of the grass and forb layer. Disking is an accepted disturbance practice, but it does have its limitations. We know that it carries weed seeds from one location to another, and it does not kill woody vegetation, so you typically need to follow disking with herbicide application for woody plants. In a good stand of native grass species, disking will encourage more native grass and herb species to grow, and it will also provide patches of bare soil for ground birds. Speaking of herbicides, you may have to use these on undesirable and invasive species. Keep in mind that herbicide use is regulated. Your state extension agent will be able to give you good information on which herbicide to use and how much to apply. Mowing is one of your least desirable options. It has some short-term benefits by setting back the growth of some competitive plants, but it leaves a layer of duff on the ground that smothers desirable plant species. Sometimes you may want to plant native vegetation to jumpstart the process of re-establishing native grass or tree communities. This may be appropriate if you're converting a cropped field to native grasses for wildlife, or if you want to re-establish native trees in woodland that has been clear-cut. Before you start using any of these practices, you really need to evaluate the land to understand its potential. Much of this will depend on your soils. In your planning process, make use of the experts. The NRCS will be a great first stop, and they can refer you to others. Be realistic about your land's potential and what you can achieve. Finally, be patient. When managing for wildlife, you'll find that there are few shortcuts and silver bullets. It takes time, effort, and understanding, but it's all worth the effort. In the last two video segments, we've discussed the ideas of habitat, succession, and disturbance, and the main conservation practices that you have at your disposal. In the next six videos, we'll apply these principles to woodland, cropland, old field, wetland, and stream habitats.